Okay, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh. A very good evening, everyone. So let's start our class with the Umul Kitab Al-Fatiha. Okay, so for this week, we will continue our lessons on the energy, which is chapter 5. So hopefully everybody now have already getting used to the systems in Puja Alam. I hope everyone will be okay. Inshallah, I will concentrate more on the parts. Maybe some of you may not join us, or maybe can join us. So I will upload this video later. But inshallah, I will try to do it. For the past few weeks, I've been very busy. So I'm trying to do it by tonight, inshallah. Okay. So so for next week, we'll be doing the same things. So you will be assessing, or you will watch the video on our Monday class, so our 1 hour class. So you will watch the video on your own, and I will give you some sorts like questions, a simple questions for you to answer by watching that video. So that will give you a proof of attendance, and then afterwards I will continue the lessons on the Thursdays, right? But if kalau ada cuti umum atau cuti pada hari Khamis, like on the 20th of August, nanti ada awal Muharram, so maybe kita akan tukar baliklah macam tu, eh? Okay, so from now on, let's start with the topics of energy. Right, so okay, so this is topic energy. So this week we will finish this topic energy. So in this topic we will learn about work. Okay, definitely will about work, kinetic energy, and work energy theorem, gravitational potential energy, a spring potential energy, on energy conservation, power, and of course the work done by a varying force. So everything will be consist of energy and work and power. Okay, work, energy, and power, right? So first of all, this is work done by a constant force. Okay, so what is work done by a constant force? The work done by a constant force, the definitions is the F dot D. Okay, work is F dot D with the units of Newton. SI unit is Newton meters, or we can simplify it as joule. Okay, so that is W equivalent to F dot D. You will know that force is a vector quantity and D is also a vector quantity, and this is a dot product, and as you know, the dot product will give you a scalar quantity. Okay, what does it mean by scalar quantity? That means it contains magnitude only. Okay, hanya ada value sahaja, tak ada directions. Okay, so itulah maksud dia. Tetapi dengan unit dia joule, J-O-U-L-E. Okay, tapi seringkas ni kita tulis J, joule. Eh? The directions is like this. Okay, if a man is trying to push the box, okay, at a certain displacement, okay, so look at the displacement, and the force is actually coming parallel to that displacement. Okay, arah force tadi, arah daya tadi, force tadi yang ditolak oleh lelaki ini, okay, sebenarnya ialah parallel, which is selari dengan arah displacement. Displacement Melayu ni kita panggil sesaran. Right? So kalau dulu kita asyik fikirkan apakah produk untuk kerja ialah apa? Kerja ialah daya kali dengan jarak. Daya kali jarak, daya kali jarak, daya kali sesaran. Okay, so itulah maksud dia. Tetapi hari ini kita nak pergi detail, kan? Betul ke macam tu cara dia? Okay, so work is force dot D. Okay, dot vector dot product. Okay, untuk multiply vector ada dua. Satu kita panggil dot product. Satu kita panggil, yang satu lagi kita panggil cross product. The difference between dot product and cross product is dot product will give you scalar quantity and the cross product will give you either scalar or vector quantity. Okay, ada dua cara untuk cross product. Sama ada ada, kalau orang dia tertinggal bracket tu, dia akan hasilkan vector. Tapi kalau dia ada bubuh bracket tu, jadi dia ialah scalar quantity. Ha, tu ada dua But for this topic, it work is for scalar quantity. Therefore, it is a multiplier vector using dot product. Vector dot product. Okay, so macam mana kita multiply ni? Boleh ke kita multiply macam tu je? So, contoh dia force ada 10 Newton, displacement ada 5 meters. Okay, so end up dia dapat 50 joule. Macam tu ke? Semudah itu sahaja ke? Okay, or should we consider anything? Okay, so kita tengok balik eh. So of course work is a scalar. Okay, because it's come from the vector dot product. Okay, and okay, saya just skip example situ supaya kita tengok pada situation ni. Right, so saya terlepas pada dulu. Okay, kalau kita tengok di sini, apa beza keadaan yang saya tunjukkan tadi, lelaki yang tengah tolak box itu dengan keadaan sekarang. Okay, if the force is at an angle to the displacement, what happened? Okay, then now you, instead of W equals to F dot D, right now you have W equals to F cos theta D. What's the difference between F D dengan F cos theta D? Alright, so cuba tengok betul-betul situation ni. Apa beza antara yang sebelah kiri F dot D dengan F cos theta D? Alright, so what's the difference? So it comes from the natures, okay, the nature of work. Okay, sebenarnya F dot D yang kita calculate di awal tadi sebenarnya terhasil disebabkan because of this situation. Okay, this situation. Okay, now you look at the arrow of this man. Okay, arrow of this man. Okay, this boy is actually pushing the box parallel to the displacement. Displacement is going to your right and to my right, of course. Now the box is have been pushed by this boy also in to the right position, to the right directions. Okay, juga pergi ke sebelah kanan. Okay, so maksud dia force dengan D ini selari. Okay, cerita dia force dengan D tu selari. Jadi kalau kita tengok dalam situation yang ada angle, okay, if the force is an angle of the displacement, what will happen? Okay, let's look at the first apa yang berlaku kepada orang yang tengah tarik, situation orang yang tengah tarik back ni, yeah. Okay, kita tengok this man will have force. Okay, he pull his back at a certain force at a certain angle. Ah, tengok dekat yang awal-awal dulu ya, yang belah kiri. Okay, at a certain angle theta. So what will happen here? Okay, if you have force, okay, and of course you have a vector. Force is a vector. When you have a vector and you have angle, what should you do? Okay, apa yang perlu kita buat? So obviously we need to, okay, break it into its component, or we should, yes, resolve to its component, meaning that kita kena resolvekan vector tadi kepada component dia, which means dekat sini kita akan dapat f cos theta yang dekat sini, which is x, dan dekat sini ialah y, kita akan dapat f sin theta. By right, by now, you should know how to came up with f cos theta or f sin theta. Okay, you have to work on that. Okay, kalau tak boleh lagi, kena belajar. Macam mana? Sebab sepatutnya dah tak perlu buat lagi. Kan? Because we are on the chapter 5 dah. Okay, so make sure dah tahu macam mana apa, macam mana nak derivekan f cos theta, macam mana nak keluarkan f sin theta. Okay, so cuba tengok antara dua ni, antara f sin theta dan f cos theta. Yang mana satu yang dia punya direction dia selari dengan displacement? Boleh somebody bagi tahu saya?
F cos theta.
F cos theta. Jawapan dia? F apa?
F cos theta.
Cos theta.
Okay, so yang akan selari dengan arah displacement ialah f cos theta, this one. Sebaliknya apa berlaku pada f sin theta? Okay, saya nak tanya apa yang berlaku pada f sin theta. So f sin theta sebenarnya dia ialah perpendicular to the displacement. Bila perpendicular to the displacement, apakah dia punya theta? Theta dia bila dia masuk dalam ni, dia jadi theta equals to 90 degrees. Cuba tekan cos 90 equals to what?
Zero.
Yes, cos 90 will be zero. So that's why for this part, okay, the when you have a component in y exists, okay, perpendicular to the displacement, bukan y saja, silap tadi tu, it's not y, but perpendicular to the displacement, maksudnya 90 degrees to the displacement, definitely yeah, work will be zero. But the one that we consider as work is the component of force that parallel to the displacement. Itu maksud dia. Maksudnya bukan saja-saja a component of force times displacement, tak. Dia sebenarnya component of force that parallel to the displacement. Jadi kalau awak faham perkataan tu, maksudnya awak fahamlah work ni. Component of force that parallel to the displacement. Okay. Supaya kita tidak keliru lagi next time when we try to do a free body diagram. Mana free body diagram ni lah kan, so kita tahu kat mana yang sebenarnya menunjukkan it is a parallel to the displacement. So we should consider everything that will be parallel to the displacement, so that is equivalent to work. Okay, let's look at this beberapa keadaan di sini. So the work done may be positive, zero or negative depending on the angle between the force and the displacement. Okay, look at the situation when you have a displacement which in positive x axis. Okay, the displacement yang kali biru tu kan. So this should be a displacement. This pun displacement ke arah, lebih ke arah kanan. Everything are in x-axis, positive x-axis. So we can easily say that W is positive if force has a component in the directions of motions. Maksudnya, directions of motion tu arah mana? Nanti kita tengok. And W is zero if force has a no component in the directions of motion. Okay, tahu ya? And W is negative if F has a component opposite to the directions of motion. So sebenarnya macam mana situasi dia? Okay. Okay, cuba tengok kat bawah tu saya ada lukis Cartesian coordinate kan? Saya lukis lagi sekali. So let's say this is your Cartesian coordinates. And this is X axis and this is your Y axis. And you know that this part is of quadrant 1, quadrant 2, quadrant 3 and also quadrant 4. And you know this is 0, 90, 180, 270 and in the end 360. It goes back to 360 degree. Okay, kita ambil yang sampai 360 je lah. Right, so what, how to consider the W is positive or not? Okay, let's say if you do have okay, a displacement that going to the positive x-axis, the red color. Tengok dekat sebelah red color tu. Going to the positive x-axis. And automatically, one, okay, the angle on quadrant 1 and quadrant 4 will be positive. Definitely will be positive. Value there. Okay. How about quadrant yang lain? Okay. For quadrant 2 and quadrant 3, it will be negative. Habis mana kosong ni? Kat mana? Dia ada dua tempat je yang kosong. Kat mana tu? Ni dia. 90 dengan 270 dan seakatan dengannya. Okay, so itu kita kena bezakan. Maksud dia, kalau force kita duduk pada, contoh, force kita duduk dekat 100 degree. 100 duduk dekat kuadran berapa?
2.
Kuadran 2. Jadi agak-agak dia dapat positif ke negatif?
Negatif.
Dia terus jadi negatif. Negatif potan. So benda ni kamu, bila kamu dah biasa buat, so sebenarnya kamu dah akan faham sendiri. Ini saya tak boleh, dia tak, bukan selama-lamanya quadrant 1 and quadrant 4 tu positif. Tiba-tiba saya tukar. Displacement sekarang duduk pada arah negatif x axis. Sekarang kuadran berapa pula jadi positif? Taklah saya.
2, 3.
2 dengan 3.
Yes. So awak dah dapat, skill tu. Sebenarnya itu je. Okay, 2 dan 3 akan jadi positif. Sebaliknya 1 and 4 yang akan jadi negatif. But apa-apa pun yang berlaku, 90 and 270 mesti akan dapat 0. As easy as that. So senang je nak tengok dia. Alright, so dah faham tu? Tak ada masalah. Okay, so let's look at this particular problem about the work done. Okay, so in this case, okay, if there is more than one force acting on an object, we can find the work done by each force and also the work done by the net force by using a summation of work. Okay, summation of work itu maksud dia apa ni? Total work. Total work. How to get total work? Okay, definitely as you know, work is F dot D. Okay, maksudnya dalam kes ni bila kita nak dapatkan total work, we need to get the total force. Nak dapatkan total work, kena dapatkan total force. Total, okay? Summation of F. Macam mana nak dapat summation of F? So we need to consider every forces yang ada dalam sistem. Contoh dia, dalam car ini. Okay, and kalau tengok dekat this car, this car is actually climbing down. Okay, coast down. Ni kita bagi coast down, jatuh turun ke bawah, menuruni bukit. And of course, this car have its own displacement. New displacement here. So this is the displacement of the car. And of course, this car, because it contains in the surface of the road, so obviously dia akan ada satu yang dipanggil sebagai MG. MG ni apa? Weight lah. Tetapi sebenarnya MG ni ialah force lah. M kali dengan A kan? Okay. And dia juga ada air friction. Okay. Air friction. And of course, bila dia duduk di atas tanah, dia duduk di atas surface, so dia akan ada normal force. Ini benda-benda yang awak kena biasakan untuk cari. So, ni apa, ni apa, ni apa. So, ini semua ialah type of force. Ini ialah force. Ini pun ialah force. Air friction pun force juga. So, everything force we must consider because we must work. Dia works, dia hanya terhasil dengan force. Kan? So, every forces yang ada dalam sistem, we need to define dia punya work. So, we need to calculate every forces supaya kita dapat calculate dia punya work. So, how to calculate? Okay. So, again, we need to define. And of course, kalau kita tengok N, normal force dengan air friction, kita boleh agak dia dapat apa-apa sebab N dengan air friction, dia duduk di atas axis. Kalau lah axis tu, kita buat bentuk dia macam ni. Ni X, ada kat sini Y. So, kita boleh agak. Sebab apa? Sebab tadilah kita dah buat tadi. Yang ni ada work, yang ni kosong ni. Agak-agak yang mana kosong dalam ni? Boleh bagi tahu saya yang mana kosong? Antara normal force, MG dengan air friction. Yang mana akan dapat kosong? Kenapa normal force? Ha? Kenapa?
Sebab dia sudut 90.
Okay. So, okay tu. Nak faham tu. Right? Tak apa. Saya berterangkan lagi pada mereka tak faham. Okay. So, normal force dalam soalan ini, dalam situation ni hanya ada normal force, MG dan juga air friction. There are three forces. Okay, three forces. So these three forces we need to consider is work. Okay, sebab tu dia nak suruh cari the total work done. Alright, so kita terus lah pergi jump to the questions. Tengok kita jump pada soalan ni terus. Okay, kenapa yang tu ada yang ni tak ada? Kan? Ada belum? Okay. So, soalan yang sama, right now, kita cuba pisahkan dia kepada beberapa komponen. Okay, bukan beberapa. Maksudnya dia pisahkan satu-satu. First, tengok kepada normal force. So, this is normal force. Ingat, apa-apa pun mesti kena faham where is the displacement. Nampak? The displacement ialah color biru. And then normal force ialah ni. So, theta dia ialah 90. Theta 90 mesti jadi apa? Work dia definitely akan dapat core. Kosong. Okay, tengok pula air friction. Air friction, dia duduk sama line dengan displacement tetapi pandangan dia menghadap ke arah yang bertentangan dengan arah displacement. So, kita katakan angle dia ialah 180. And if you try to punch in your calculator, cos 180 equals to what? Berapa? Cos 180 equals to?
Negative 1.
Yes, equals to negative 1. Maksud dia betul lah. Macam kita cakap tadi kan. Apa-apa yang duduk di atas quadrant 2 and quadrant 3, dia akan dapat negatif. Tetapi siapa yang duduk kat quadrant 1 dengan quadrant 4, dia akan dapat positif. Kecuali dia duduk dekat 90 dengan 270. So, dia akan dapat zero. Okay. So, itu ialah yang kedua. Yang ketiga ialah MG. MG ni, tengok kan. MG ialah satu, satu work yang dia hanya duduk pada uh, dia hanya duduk, dia hanya duduk straight je. Okay, dia duduk ascent, dia punya direction is always pointing towards the center of the earth. Dia akan towards ke bawah sahaja. So dia kalau jalan tu sengit macam mana pun, dia still pointing straight downwards. Okay, tu dia punya syarat untuk NG. And of course, MG, bila kita tengok betul-betul, dia ada theta. Tapi nama dia bukan theta lah, kat situ dia pakai phi. Tu. Kalau tengok ada simbol kan, dia gunakan simbol dia. Ni simbol dia phi. Theta simbol dia macam ni. Ni theta. Jangan confuse eh. Theta dia macam tu, phi dia macam tanda bulat, ada ada apa, ada ada cancel dia kata. So tambah dia phi. So because of ada angle dan ada vector, so kita kena break dia kepada komponen dulu. Maksudnya kita kena buat apa ni? Dekat sini ialah mg cos phi. Kat di atas ni ada lagi satu, ialah mg sin phi. So that will be how you break all the forces and now you try to answer it. Okay, soalan ni ialah find the total work done on the car as it travels the distance d along the road. So first nampak mana dia gunakan force. So dia cari dulu work on the normal force. So work on the normal force again. Dia guna formula macam mana tadi? Fd cos theta. Dia follow je Fd cos theta tu. Siapa F? F ialah Nd d. So cos theta ialah cos theta. So cos 90 dapat kosong. Kosong. Okay, now work for the air friction. Okay, work for the air friction. Nampak? Fd, Fd ialah air friction, D ialah D cos 180. Okay, soalan ni dia berbeza sikit. Eh? This question only involve apa dia panggil? Dia hanya ada value. Dia tak ada value. Okay, soalan ni dia tak ada value. Dia hanya ganti-ganti value je nak tengok. Kan? So, kita akan dapat negative F times D. And for mg, so mgd cos, ni cos ni sebab dia nak gunakan ni. Sebenarnya kalau awak tengok, displacement dia ialah, kalau tengok antara mg cos phi dengan mg sin phi, which one yang parallel kepada displacement? Mg cos ke mg sin dalam kes ni?
Mg sin.
Mg sin yang parallel kepada displacement. Sebab itulah kalau tengok akhir dia nanti W equals to Ft cos theta. So Ft ialah mg sin phi kalikan dengan D. Sebab tu dia dapat mg D sin phi. Tu sebab dia eh. And of course the total work dah habis lah tiga-tiga kan. Tiga-tiga kita tambahkan, kita dapat ini. Okay, so ingat jawapan tu eh. Negatif F, negatif F friction sekali D plus dengan mg D sin phi. Okay, now kita tengok dengan cara yang lebih ini lebih mantap sikit lah. Okay, lebih mengarah, memudahkan awak untuk awak bila dapat soalan nanti kan. Macam mana kita nak buat? Alright, so tengok betul-betul. Same questions. Okay, you repeat the same questions. But right now, macam mana saya boleh kata same question tu betul lah. Sebab sepatutnya kereta tu kat sini. Ni kereta tu. Okay, dia ada bukit lah kat sini. Okay, tayar dia. Tayar masuk dalam kereta. Takpelah. Nak beritahu. Kereta. Okay, so dekat situ ada normal force, ada air friction, ada mg sin phi, mg cos phi. Benda yang sama dengan yang atas tu. Cuma sekarang ni dia lebih simplified kan. Okay, sebab dia kata apa tadi? Anything that parallel to the displacement. Parallel eh? Siapa yang parallel dengan displacement? Definitely mg sin phi dan air frictions. Orang lain apa? Normal, normal kat mana? Normal dekat sini. Macam mana dengan mg cos? Mg cos dekat sini. Adakah dia parallel ke dengan displacement? No. Because the once the parallel dengan displacement hanyalah mg sin phi dengan air friction. So macam mana kita nak buat? Kita pun ambil lah mg sin phi minus f air, okay, equivalent to z. equivalent to, sorry, times dengan, this one is F times dengan D, dapatlah dia dah W. So kalau kita tengok balik, W equals to mg d sin phi minus d. Bukankah jawapan ini sama macam jawapan yang tadi? Cuma sama yang pertama, solution dia ialah dia bahagi 3. Dia calculate 1, 1, 1. Yang kedua, dia terus calculate. Dia tak calculate dah normal force, dia tak calculate mg cos theta, dia tak, sebab dia memang dah tahu mg cos phi ni dengan normal force definitely memang tak akan bagi value, sebab dia duduk pada sudut 90 and also 270 daripada displacement. So dia hanya dia punya calculate mg sin phi dengan air friction, dua sahaja. So terus dimasukkan dalam ni. So in other words, so force only can be calculated using component that parallel to the displacement. Dia tidak tak semestinya duduk sentiasa pada x axis, ya. Kadang-kadang ada situation dah duduk dalam y axis. So kita tengok later, eh. Okay, let's look at this example. Padam tu. Sorry, ya, tak sempat padam tadi. Okay. This is about an Eskimo returning from a successful fishing trip pulls a sled. Nah, the sled ni inilah dia, kenderaan dia. Sled loaded with salmon. Nah, atas tu ada ikan salmon, eh. The total mass of the sled and the salmon is 50 kilogram. Dia dah bagi tahu siap-siap 50 kilogram. The mass, eh, the mass saja. And the Eskimo exerts a force of magnitude 120 Newton. Okay. On the sled by pulling on the rope. Okay, so dengan cara macam mana dia tarik? Okay, gambar tu menunjukkan dia tarik pada certain angle. Tetapi kalau tengok soalan pertama, dengar, how much work does he do on the sled if the rope is horizontal to the ground? Okay, the rope is horizontal to the ground. Maknanya bukan ini, ya. Horizontal maksud dia horizon lah, maksud dia kat bawah ni. Mula-mula dia tak tarik macam tu, dia tarik kat bawah ni. Dia tarik tadi tapi dekat, dia tarik dekat bahagian bawah selari dengan tanah. Nah, itu maksud dia horizontal to the ground. So dekat sini theta dia equals to zero. Okay. And he pulls the sled 5 meters. So dia punya jarak dia ialah 5 meters. So how to calculate it? Yes, of course kita dah dapat dah force pada arah yang komponen dia parallel dengan displacement. So kita kalilah 120 times 5, you get 600 joule. Okay, and the next is B. Tengok, eh, kat soalan B, how much work does he do on the sled if theta equals to 30 degrees and he pulls the sled the same distance. Okay, ada ramai tanya saya, eh. So macam mana, eh? Saya baca soalan, dekat soalan B baru dia bagi tahu ada theta. Yes, itu sebab dia disusun macam tu. Okay. Theta 30 degrees hanya duduk dekat soalan B. Maksud dia soalan A tu, dia tak tahu pun theta tu 30 darjah. So senang dia macam tu. Fikir, eh. Maksudnya we can't simply use 30. Kalau counter lah, kamu ni jenis suka baca semua soalan. Oh, kat bawah ni ada. Dekat part E, part C ada. Bagi tahu theta equals to 30. No. Dia tak akan buat macam tu. Kalau dia nak bagi tahu, dia akan bagi tahu awal-awal lagi. General informations inside the question itself, dia dah bagi tahu. Dia tak akan bagi tahu blah 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 macam tu. Okay, remember, eh. Right? So in this case, we need to do some resolve its component. So this one is F cos theta. This one is F sin theta. Okay, that theta tu kita ada belum? 30 degrees. So sebab tu kamu tengok dia buat 120 cos 30 times 5. Then you will get 520 joule. So if you look at the value, kalau tadi dia tarik straight daripada bawah tu, value dia berapa? 600 joule. Sedangkan kalau kita tarik pada angle, naik je angle sikit, terus beza dia. Jadi berapa? 520 joule. Beza. Okay. So beza lebih kurang 800 joule. Right? Okay, kalau ada soalan tolong tanya. Boleh tanya, boleh stop me anytime. Okay, no problem. Ada soalan ke? Kalau ada boleh tanya, tak ada masalah. Okay. Alright. So suppose that in example 5.1, the coefficients of kinetic friction between the loaded 50 kilogram slab and snow is 0.2. The Eskimo again pulls the slab 5 meters, exerting a force of 120 newton at an angle of zero. Find the work done on the slab by friction and the net work. Dia dah bagi tahu siap-siap dah macam mana. Okay, so actually cubalah buat sendiri, gunakan notes ni. Nanti cuba buat untuk mendapatkan value-value ni. Right? Cuma kena faham konsep dia sekarang ni. Contoh, saya ambil satu contoh, part A. Okay. The Eskimo again pulls the slab 5 meters exerting a force of 120 newton at an angle of zero. Okay, find the work done on the slab by frictions and the net work. Okay. So, dekat macam mana nak buat? Okay. Coefficients of kinetic frictions. Okay, remember. Ada satu equation yang kita kena alert dekat situ ialah coefficients of kinetic friction. Mu K. Value dia berapa? 0.2. Okay. Mu K equals to 0.2. Siapa itu mu K? Kalau kita masih ingat lagi dalam our previous search, previous lesson, so we learn about mu, okay, which is coefficients of friction. Okay, ada dua, ada mu K, ada mu S. S stands for static, mu K stands for kinetic. Okay, maksudnya masa tengah bergerak, dia pakai kinetic. Kalau masa tengah duduk diam, kita pakai static. Okay, so 120 degree and angle of zero. Find the work done on the slab by friction and the net work. Okay, so kalau kamu tengok dia, langkah pertama dia gunakan y, n minus mg equals to zero, n equals to mg. Kenapa nak dapatkan n equals to mg ni? Sebab nilai n nanti akan duduk di sini. Okay, akan duduk dekat delta. Sebab apa? Sebab kita faham mu kalikan dengan n akan dapat f. Okay. Mu kali dengan n dapat dengan air frictions. Okay, sebab apa? Sebab mu ialah coefficient, n ialah normal force. So dia akan masuklah mg dalam ni. Okay, masuk mg dalam ni untuk dapatkan negatif 4.90 joule. Okay, and the next step is repeat the calculation if the applied force is exerted at an angle of theta equals to 30 degree with the horizontal. Okay, so the applied force will be 600. Okay, mana dia dapat 600 tu? 1.120 times 5. Okay, this one is 120 times 5, so you get 600 plus dengan negative 4.9 times power of 2 joules. Okay, so in the end you will get 10.2 joules. Okay, 10 power of 2 joules. Okay, right. So that will be there how they try to answer it. Okay, ada soalan? Boleh kita teruskan?
Boleh, sir.
Boleh, ya? Okay. Alright. This is the kinetic energy and the work energy theorem. Okay, it comes from the Sir Isaac Newton, who actually derived that the work, the total work W is equivalent to delta KE. Apa itu delta KE? Okay, KE means kinetic energy. So delta means change in kinetic energy, or we can write down as half mv final square minus half MV initial square. Itu maksud dia. Okay, change in Ke. So the work energy theorem is the total work done on an object is equal to its change in kinetic energy. All right, so let's look at this example. A 4.1 kilogram box of books is lifted vertically from rest a distance 0.6 meters with a constant upward applied force of 52.7. Find A, the work done by the applied force, and B, the work done by gravity, and C, the final speed of the box. Okay, so 4.1 kilogram books. Ini kalau awak tengok situation ni, kena fahamkan betul-betul, dia ada dua dekat situ. Box ada kat bawah, orang tu cuba angkat dengan applied force. Maksudnya force yang daripada diri dia. And pada masa yang sama, mesti ada apa? Ada mg kat situ. And kalau kalau kita tengok box ini tak melekat dekat bawah lagi, dia dah angkat. So sebab itulah dia tidak ada normal force kat situ. Okay, sebab dia dah angkat, cuma sekarang ni direction dia. Okay, situation dia ialah displacements right now is in y axis. Semua duduk pada y axis. Instead of x, tadi kan dia duduk baring, kali ni dia dah bangun. Okay, duduk sebagai y. Maksudnya bukannya x lagi. So bila dalam keadaan macam ni, kita terpaksa ubah kita punya Cartesian coordinate dan kita punya principle. Sebab apa? Sebab untuk applied force, okay, nampak kan? Kalau displacement ke arah atas, maksudnya macam siapa yang akan jadi component of F yang parallel. So definitely siapa-siapa yang duduk dekat Y. Siapa yang duduk kan? Siapa yang selari dengan Y. So in this case we have applied force and also MG. Dua-dua ni akan diletakkan sekali lah. Okay, so siapa nak tolak siapa tu, that's depend on the situation. Biasanya saya akan buat, kalau kita letak dekat satu ketinggian, yang mana yang akan sampai dulu? So yang akan sampai dulu mestilah applied force. Sebab itulah FEPP tolak dengan MG. Okay, ini daripada sini baru dapatkan dia punya F, barulah tambahkan dengan barulah kalikan dengan displacement. Right? Kalau kita tengok dalam tu, pengiraan dia apa tadi? Find the work done by the applied force. The work done by the applied force. So, force involved. Kita pun tak calculate kat situ. Cuma just tulis je applied force. Okay, cos 0 equals to 1 because it contains 52.7 K1 sebagai cos 0 and 1.6. Okay, the answer is 84.3 joule. Okay, on part B, we calculate the work done by gravity. The distance AY equals to 1.6 meters as shown, but now theta equals to 180. Okay, you can probably check on your own about this questions. Nanti tolong snapkan ya gambar ni. Boleh dah kamu ulang kaji kan, siapa yang tak beli buku lagi ya. Okay, ingat, the books is not compulsory for every students to buy, right? Okay, again, so this is the topics of work energy theorem, which right now will involve F and D, and of course F, you know, mesti parallel kepada displacement. A boy exerts a force of 11 newton at 29 degree above the horizontal on a 6.4 kilogram slab. Slab ni dia ya. Dia punya tempat digunakan untuk mendalik barang ya. Find A, the work done by the boy. Okay? The work done by the boy, so we need to calculate force. So kita kena calculate lah. So jawapan dia ialah 19.21 joules, and of course bawah tu pun kita dah ada some a few calculations yang boleh digunakan dengan sebaik-baiknya lah. Sebab kat situ kalau tengok work total is equivalent to delta K. Delta K ialah half MV final square minus half MV initial square. Okay, kita digunakan itu untuk dapatkan V. Ya. Sebab biasanya soalan-soalan dia tidak akan tanya semudah ini. Biasanya dia akan pusing-pusing-pusing tapi mesti dapat pada point yang sama. Okay, ada soalan? Okay, so let's look at the work done by the gravity. Should we call it as the work done by conservative force? So what does it mean by work done on by the conservative force? Kita tengok. Okay, if we pick up a ball and put it on the shelf, we have done work on the ball. Okay, we, maksudnya kita yang letakkan bola di atas para. So kita yang buat bola, kita yang bahagikan kita yang buat kerja tu terhadap ball. We can get that energy back if the ball falls back off the shelf. In the meantime, we say the energy is stored as potential energy. Okay, so work done against friction is not stored as potential energy. Instead, it is dissipated into other forms of energy such as heat or sound. So that will give you a good definitions of potential energy. So sebenarnya dalam tajuk work done by conservative force, nak cerita pasal ini. Which means nak cerita pasal WC, maksudnya kaitan antara work dan kaitan dengan antara delta U. This delta U is actually potential energy. Okay, potential energy, and this one is the work done. Okay, potential energy work done. Of course, yang tengah ni ialah change. Okay, change ni potential energy. So what does it mean by change in potential energy? So like this, eh? Okay, let's look at this boy having a good time to jump from a springboard. Okay, from a springboard. Okay, and of course I believe that he wants to splash the pool. Okay, so that we can actually calculate some things from there. Okay, so let's look at the first stage. The first stage is when U is equivalent to mgy, or can I call it as U equals to mgy at that particular time? And of course, at this point, you will see this is the most potential energy maximum at this point. Okay, this point lah. Kenapa? Okay, and of course, because of, if you can remember ini eh, U equals to MGY. Ini lama punya MGY, MGH. Dulu kamu ingat benda ni sebagai MGH. Sedangkan H ni dah banyak kali bagi tahu tertukar kepada Y. Selalu ni guna sistem Y lah. Okay, yang ni sama sekolah MGH ni kan. So sekarang kita sambungkan dengan Y. So U equivalent to MGY. Okay, at this point, and as it fall, it will lose its mark. Okay, it will lose the value. So dekat sini kita katakan PE max jadi zero. Maksudnya daripada value kepada tak ada value. Tetapi benda ni lah terbalik dengan work. Work pula dia start dengan bawah. Okay, work done on this part. Okay, sebab tu dikatakan W is equivalent to negative PE. Okay, negative PE or negative change in potential energy. An 82 kilogram mountain climber is in the final stage of the ascent of 4301 meters high pikes peak. What is the change in gravitational potential energy as the climber gains the last 100 meters of altitude? Okay, let the potential energy become zero at sea level of and B at the top of the peak. Okay, macam mana keadaan dia? The gunung dia sebenarnya ni, gunung ni yang orang ni pergi sebenarnya mempunyai ketinggian sebanyak 4301 meters. 4301 meters, and of course this is the sea level. Okay, so agak-agaknya kalau mountain climber ni, kalau dia 100 kat bawah, dia duduk kat mana? Dia duduk pada 4201. Ya, yeah, sebab dia beza dia 100. Right. So, soalan dia pertama ialah what is the change in gravitational potential energy as the climber gains the last 100 meters altitude? Okay. So, ingat macam mana nak calculate dia? Delta U equals to MGY final minus MGY initial. So climber ni berapa? 4, 2, 1. Siapa yang initial? Initial dia kat point ni ialah final point. Okay, so final dia ialah 4301. Okay, kalau tengok M betul, G, G kita tak pakai 9.81 kan, kita pakai 9.8. Okay, and cos kita dapatkan 4301, so minus dengan MGY yang lagi satu, so you will get 80,400 joule. Okay. Okay, itu point reference yang saya gunakan dan disuggestkan oleh dia. Tapi ada lagi satu player, actually MGY F dengan MG initial ni, tapi dia macam mana cara dia? This climber becomes 100, okay. Tapi U dia duduk kat mana? U dia duduk dekat peak. Atas ni. So kalau U dia kosong, dekat bawah sekali ni mesti negatif 4301. 4301 meter. Bawah paras laut katalah. Kan? Kosong tu dekat U. So berapa nilai climber ni? Climber ni duduk kat mana? Dia mesti duduk dekat negatif 100. Okay, negatif 100. Sebab tu kalau kita tengok dalam pengiraan dia, MGY, Y final siapa ada? Okay, Y final initial dia 0, 82,9800 meters equals to 80,400 joule. Okay, look at the examples here. A diver of mass M drops from a board of 10 meters above the water surface. So this is water surface. Okay, water surface. Neglect air resistance. Use conservations of mechanical energy to find the speeds 5 meters above the water surface. Okay. So this will calculate speed 5 meters above the water surface. So, macam mana nak calculate? Okay, how to calculate? Right. So first of all, kita mesti tahu dulu what is the conservation of mechanical energy. Yeah. Conservation dia ialah delta E delta P. Conservation is delta E or equivalent to E final minus E initial. Ataupun kita boleh write down as E initial equals to E final. Kiri kanan E initial equals to E final. So apa yang apa yang ada dalam E ni? So dalam E ni akan ada initially kita akan, biasanya kita akan start dengan half mv squared. Okay, tapi square mana? Initial plus dengan mg h equivalent to half mv final square plus dengan mg h. Ataupun kita nak tukar jadi mg y pun tak ada masalah. Okay, itulah maksud dia. Kalau masa tempat yang dia sebelum dia terjun tu, dia ialah maksimum potential energy. Tetapi bila dia terjun, so nilai potential energy tadi, nilai dia dapat daripada H. Okay, which means dapat daripada height. So bila kita dah calculate, obviously bila kita jatuh, dia dah tak depend kepada height lagi. So therefore, kita pun tak tahu. Okay, because of that, we need to calculate. And kalau awak tengok, biasanya dulu zaman-zaman sekolah awak, awak suka half mv squared equals to mgh. Ha, suka buat benda ni. Sebenarnya ini datang daripada mana ni? Adakah dia derive sendiri? Okay, sebenarnya dia datang daripada equation-equation yang kita dah buat. Okay, sebab asal dia penuh. Setiap ada E, E mesti ada dua. Mesti ada half mv squared plus dengan mgh. Okay, half mv squared plus mgh. Tapi itu baru satu ni lah. Ha, sekali. So you can try on your own about top ni. So yang penting baca dan fahamkan situation dia. Okay. So this is the potential energy of a spring. So spring punya sifat ialah elastic. It contains elasticity. At the center point, kita rasa spring ni tak boleh nak guna. Okay, so that's how the spring works. Okay, because spring punya behavior kita tahu is equivalent to negative kx. Kan? So apa itu k? Siapa ingat apa itu k untuk spring? So spring k ialah nama dia spring constant. Oh, kadang-kadang dia tak pakai spring constant, dia pakai force constant. Okay, that is K. And how about X? X ialah apa? X ialah elongation. Okay. So the potential energy of a spring, okay, dia gabungkan, dia akan dapat delta KE equivalent to, ataupun delta PE equivalent to half mv squared. Sorry, half kx squared untuk spring. Delta PES untuk spring will be half kx squared. And remember, x dalam ni mesti dalam meter, mesti dalam SI unit, tak boleh guna dalam centimeter. Okay, when a force of 120 N is applied to a certain spring, it causes a stretch of 2.2 cm, where is the potential energy of the spring when it is compressed by 3.5 cm or expand by 7 meters. Jadi ada beberapa perkataan yang mengelirukan kita kat sini. Dia suka pakai stretch. Okay, dia suka pakai compress. And dalam 3.5 centimeters. Okay. So, benda-benda perkataan tu kita kena take notes bila jumpa sebab dia membawa maksud tertentu. Eh. So, dalam case yang ni kita tengok ada spring. Okay, ada spring. Yang tengah-tengah ni nama dia equilibrium position because spring is an elasticity material, elastic material. Maksudnya bila kita tarik kiri dia nak pergi kanan, tarik kanan dia nak pergi kiri. Okay, so that's why dia ada compress and stretch. Right, so what is the potential energy of this spring when it is compressed by 3.5 centimeters and 7 centimeters? Okay. So how to calculate first? Soalan dia tidak ada soalan dia tidak mempunyai value lah. Tak ada nilai K, so we need to define K. Dia ada bagi kita 120 newton and divide is dia punya meter, so kita dapat lebih kurang 5330 newton per meter. Okay, ingat dia punya apa panggil dia punya dia punya unit ialah K, value dia ialah 60 newton meter. Okay, newton per meter. And of course when we get K kita boleh calculate benda-benda lain lah.
Sir,
alright. Teruskan.
K tu merujuk kepada kita arah kita stretch atau compress spring tu ke?
Apa dia? Soalan lagi sekali.
K tu kita rujuk ke arah stretch atau compress spring tu ke?
K ke X?
X eh?
X tu yang maksud dia elongation. X tu ialah elongation. Elongation itu pemanjangan. Pemanjangan kan? Tu maksud dia elongation. Delta X tu. Tapi kalau K kita guna cara biasa je. Memang dia akan return to original equilibrium position. Tapi, yelah. Tak tahulah bila. Sebab kadang-kadang ada juga yang jadi macam mana kita kita compress atau kita stretch and in the end dia tak boleh dah lebih dia punya elastic limit dan dia tak nak balik pada original position. Ada juga macam tu. Okay, kita teruskan dengan circus acrobat. Okay, very good examples. Kita dah tahu tadi conservations of energy, energy initial equals to energy final, right? So a 50 kilogram circus acrobat drops from a height of 2 meters straight down onto a springboard with a force constant 8,000 newtons per meter as in figures. By what maximum distance does she compress the spring? Okay, cerita dia sekarang ni ialah ada seorang ahli circus ni, dia melompat, tetapi bila dia lompat, dia terjun di atas platform ini. Tanpa dia tahu, di atas platform ini sebenarnya apa yang berlaku? Dia letakkan spring bawah dia. Ada spring kat belah bawah. So spring itu akan menahan dia dan akan membuatkan spring ini akan ada dia punya potential spring. Apa potential tu spring? Half kx square. Sama juga. Okay. So this acrobat now, dia suruh kita cari apa? By what maximum distance does the compress the spring? Kan? So berapa banyak dia akan turun ke bawah bila orang daripada circus ini lompat. So dalam keadaan ini, kita kena faham ya. Biasanya kita hanya buat E initial equals to E final. Initial equals to E final. Kita dah faham dah apa itu E. E mesti ada KE kinetic energy plus PE equivalent to KE plus PE. Okay. Tetapi dalam situasi ini, this circus acrobat dia lompat tapi lompat di atas spring. So kita faham spring pun ada elastik, ada apa? Ada dia punya tak ada perkataan. Ada dia punya potential energy dia. Okay, potential energy untuk spring. So that's why equation ni kita kena baca lagi. Ke plus PE plus PES. Okay, PES tu ialah PE spring. Ke plus PE plus PES. Datang lagi satu equation. Macam yang bawah ni. So daripada sinilah kita boleh katakan okey, yang mana yang tak bergerak langsung, yang mana yang bergerak, yang mana yang sepatutnya dikekalkan. Jadi sepatutnya kita dapat end up dia dapat 0.56 meters. Okey, kita break sekejap untuk seminit ke, seminit dua. Okay, so let's continue. So this is the energy conservation that can make kinematics problem much easier to solve. So there's some lots of assumption we need to do before we can easily use the energy conservations. As I said to you, energy conservation is the delta E, which means E final minus E initial, and E initial equivalent to E final. Okay, so like in this case, okay, you can see here, okay, when a man is throwing a keys, okay, down this D, we can actually see that during ada masa dia kunci itu di tangan dia, so dia akan dapat MGH. Okay, ada MGH, tapi bila dia sampai, dia terus tukar semua sekali jadi half MV squared. Okay, sebab itulah nanti bila kita tulis, kita boleh tulis MGH equals to half MV squared. Ini macam kamu yang hafal tadi lah. Tapi asal dia daripada mana? Asal dia daripada conservation of energy, yeah, conservation of energy. A 1.7 kilogram block slides on a horizontal frictionless surface. Okay, ada bagi tahu kat situ frictionless memang maksud dia kita tidak akan ada air friction until it encounters a spring with a force constant 955 newton per meter. The block comes to rest after compressing the spring a distance of 4.6 centimeters. Find the initial speeds of the block. Ignore air resistance and any energy loss when the block initially contact the spring. Okay. So, apa maksudnya tu? Ada one block, satu kotak. Okay, slides ke horizontal. Frictionless kan? So, nanti tiba-tiba encounters a spring dengan spring constant dia 955 newton per meter. The block comes to rest after compressing the spring a distance of 4.6 meters centimeters. Eh? Find the initial speeds of the block. Dia suruh cari end up dia, suruh cari find the initial speeds of the block. Okay. So macam mana nak buat tu? Kita tengok ada beberapa value kat sini. Kat sini kita ada M. Lepas tu kita ada apa ini? K. Kat sini kita ada delta X. Yeah, so ada beberapa value yang kita dapat kat situ. So dari kalau nampak K dan nampak X, maybe ada guna dia untuk kita calculate. Eh. So definitely kita boleh calculate, kita boleh gabungkan. Kita boleh gabungkan half MV squared dengan half KX squared. Okay, gabungkan. Itulah cara mereka buat. Half mv square equals to half k kx square atau kd square. So kita boleh dapat v equals to 1.09 meter per second. Okay, nanti cuba, kalau tak sempat cuba tengok balik video saya ni, terus cuba buat lagi sekali. Okay, sebab kadang-kadang aku, kamu tak ada mood yang petang-petang ni, but cuba buat lagi sekali ya. Okay. A leaf falls in the forest. Find the non-conservative work. Alright. Apakah maksud non-conservative? Okay. So kita cuba fahamkan dengan cara buat soalan lah. Dig in the forest, a 17 gram leaf. Okay. Maksudnya 17 gram daun falls from a tree and drops straight to the ground. This initial height was 5.3 meters and speed on landing was 1.3 meter per second. How much non-conservative work was done on the leaf? Okay, so first kita calculate apa tu? MGH. Okay, MGH tu maksud kedudukan leaf yang asal. So 0.017 kali dengan 9.8 kali dengan 5.3 dapat 0.8884 joule. Okay. And the kinetic energy is half mv squared. Tapi sis tak bergerak. So initially the is zero. And how about you? Energy, the total energy. So ingatlah. Okay. Total energy ialah E tadi. Which means equivalent to kinetic and potential. Dua-dua sekali. But dua-dua value akan dapat zero. Okay. So the non-conservative, dan macam yang last kali, point yang last kali tu, delta E equivalent to E final minus E initial, equivalent to negative 0.870 joule. Okay. Ada soalan? Okay. Maybe kita boleh tengok okay, examples ini dulu. Examples 8-10, landing with a third. Okay. A block of mass M1 equivalent to 2.4 kilogram is connected to a second block of mass M2, 1.8 kilogram as shown here. When the blocks are released from rest, they move through a distance d equals to 0.5 meters. At high point, M2 hits the floor, given the coefficients of kinetic friction between M1 and the horizontal surface is mu k 0.45. Find the speeds of the block just before M2 lands. So cerita dia boleh faham ke tak? M1 2.4, M2 1.8. Agak-agak boleh tarik tak? Tak boleh tarik. Tak tahu. Okay, but when the blocks are released from rest, okay, released from rest, they move through a distance d equals to 0.5. Maksud dia, dua-dua pun move 0.5. Okay, 0.5 meters. At which point M2 hits the floor. Okay, dalam situasi yang macam ni, kita jangan anggap satu gerak dalam X, satu gerak dalam Y. Tak ya, kita anggap dia semua gerak dalam satu barisan yang sama. Cuma dia dipisahkan oleh ini apa nama ni? Apa? wheel kan? Itu. So that's why, given by the coefficients of kinetic frictions between M1 and the horizontal mu k is equivalent to 0.450. Okay, find the speeds of all the block just before M2. So, ingat dekat sini kita ada apa? Kita ada mg, kita ada n. Okay. And of course kita ada d, displacement. And antara horizontal surface dengan kinetic friction between M1 and horizontal surface is mu k. Untuk M2 tidak ada M, tidak ada mu. Yang ada mu pada mereka yang ni je. Okay, yang macam M2 ni dia memang duduk straight kat ke bawah aja, ke bawah atau ke atas. So dia tidak melibatkan ke naik atau tu, dia tidak melibatkan surface. Jadi yang melibatkan surface hanyalah M1 aja. Okay, so M1 tu yang tempat kita nak tengok atas bawah dia tu ya. So dekat situ air friction definitely tak ada. Apa lagi tak ada kat situ? Sorry, air friction adalah sebab ada kinetic mu kan, mu ada. Find the speeds of the block just before M2 lands. Okay, so first kita buat apa dulu? Yang pertama dia u dulu. Okay, u kat teori kat situ ialah m1gh plus dengan m2gd. Okay, h dengan d. Maksud dia h yang inilah. Bila dia bergerak ke depan, dia gerak ke depan, h dan d. Okay, so for K1 is half KI initially 0. Kenapa? Sebab tak bergerak. Okay, but in the end this is E1. Okay, E1 ialah E1 ialah potential energy campur dengan kinetic energy. Potential campur dengan kinetics. Okay, so kita dapat M1GH plus M2GD. Value pun tak keluar lagi. Okay, how about final? Final hanya ada MGH. Okay, final MGH. So dulu. Lepas tu untuk kinetic energy, change in kinetic energy, ingat kita ada kinetic energy final minus kinetic energy initial. Siapa yang dekat final? Kita tengok ada dua dekat situ. Satu yang melibatkan half M1 V squared, yang lagi satu half M2 V squared. Maksudnya satu dekat sini, satu lagi dekat sini. And lastly, you add everything. EF equals to UF plus KF, which means M1GH plus half M1 V squared plus half M2 V squared. Okay. So benda ni lah. So dekat situ kena tengok betul-betul. Right. So, nanti cuba buat dulu value-value ni and the rest kita akan tengok balik lah. Okay, sebab apa? Sebab kalau kamu tak try sendiri, kamu tak akan dapat great idea macam mana nak jawab soalan ni. Soalan yang berbentuk macam ni. Ya. So, nak tak nak kena cuba buat dulu. Okay. Alright, so right now kita masuk kepada tajuk power. Okay, power. What is power? Power is a measure of the rate at which work is done. Ha, so, ada kaitan dia dengan work. Okay, ada kaitan dia dengan work juga. Ya. Walaupun kita belajar tajuk power because power is work over time. Work is over time. Work unit dia ialah joule and time unit dia second. So, joule per second dapat watt. Yang bawah ni 1 horsepower 746 watt ni itu terpulang pada kamu lah. Tak tahu ke anak eh. Okay. Boleh lagi? Okay, ada soalan ke nak tanya?
Tak ada.
Okay. Right, so to pass a slow moving truck, okay, to pass a slow moving truck, you want your fancy 1,300 kilogram car to accelerate from 13.4 meter per second, which also equivalent to 13 miles per hour, to 17.9 meter per second, or 40 miles per hour. In 3 seconds. What is the minimum power required for this pass? Okay, so maksudnya kereta ni nak overtake lori ni yang slow kan. So dia nak overtake. So cuma sekarang ni bila dia overtake, dia mesti accelerate daripada 13.4 pergi 17.9. So definitely daripada situ kita boleh dapat cari acceleration. Tetapi dalam soalan ni dia nak what is the minimum power required for this pass. Okay, required. Yang mana yang perlu. Jadi, kita nak tengok yang penting sekali kita boleh calculate two different work based on half mv square. Ha, ni yang pertama sekali lah. Half total okay, half mv final squared minus half mv initial squared. Okay, masukkan every value. So, dapat 9.16 10 to the power of 4 joules. And of course, bila kita dah dapat force, okay, ini force lah cerita dia, force, kita boleh masukkan ke dalam power eh. Ingat, selain daripada W on its own, kita boleh juga tengok daripada delta. Okay, delta K tu akan bantu you untuk faham. Sebab selain daripada force, kita kena faham ada delta K. Because delta K tu maksudnya change in kinetic energy. Ha? Jangan confuse. Ha? Ada K kecil, ada K besar. Kan? Tadi cerita pasal potential energy pun pakai K. Kan? So kadang-kadang kita boleh buat jadi confuse. Okay? Tapi kalau dalam soalan dia tak minta power in contoh dia dalam kilowatt ke dalam horsepower, tak payah. Sepatutnya tinggal ke jawapan dia macam ni. Biar je jawapan sampai dalam watt. Sudah cukup. Tetapi kalau soalan tu nak jawapan kita dalam horsepower ke dalam unit-unit lain, so kita kena ada some sort of kena convert kepada kepada unit-unit lain dulu. Okay. If an object is moving at a constant speed in the face of friction, gravity, air resistance and so forth, the power exerted by the driving force can be written as ni, power equivalent to FD. Ni work tadi kan? FD, tapi ingat dia pecah kepada FD, lepas tu dia ambil D per T ni. D per T ni bersamaan dengan FV. In this case, V ni ialah velocity. Okay, velocity times dengan force, kita dapat power. So power ada dua lah cara nak dapatkan power eh. Satu menggunakan W per T, kadang-kadang dia boleh tukar kepada E per T. Okay. And of course dekat tengah-tengah ni kita ada F. Okay. Alright. Let's look at the problem here. A 1,000 kilogram elevator can elevator car carries a maximum load of 800 kilogram. Okay, a constant frictional force of 4,000 newton retards its motion upward, as in figure 5.26. What minimum power in kilowatts and in horsepower must the motor deliver to lift the fully loaded elevator car at a constant speed of 3 meter per second? Okay, what minimum power, maksudnya satu dia nak P, in kilowatt and in horsepower, ada dua eh, must the motor deliver to lift the fully loaded elevator? Okay. So macam mana nak buat tu? Right, dia hanya bagi apa tu? 1000 kilogram elevator. Okay, maximum load dia ialah 800 kilogram. A constant frictional force, ada friction eh. Maksud kalau kita naik ke atas, okay, ada friction yang akan cuba tolak ke bawah. 4000 newtons retards its motion upward. Alright, so first thing first. Nampak dia duduk dekat area mana? Dia duduk dekat y-axis. Okay. It happens to be side on the side of y-axis. So dekat situ kita kena faham eh, dekat y-axis ni ada tension. Di tali-tali ni kita panggil dia T. Okay. Dekat sini kita ada mg. Dekat sini juga kita ada. Sepatutnya ada lagi satu. Never mind. Okay, sepatutnya kena ada normal force lah kat situ eh. Panggil apparent. Okay, but yang paling betul, yang paling sempat sebab dia senaraikan lah tiga. Okay, mesti ada directions of motion, maksudnya mesti ada arah sini. Apa dia tu? Friction. This one is the friction. Okay, mg and t. Sebab tu lah dia boleh, they all can came up with this equation. T plus F plus mg equivalent to zero. T is equivalent to okay. My bad eh. Untuk ayat ni memang the submission of F, tetapi bila kita tengok balik T ini ke atas, mg dengan F frictions ke bawah. Jadi kita kena ubah dari equation T minus F minus dengan mg versus 0. So yang lain baru betul. Okay, bila dah dapat T, T is part of the force. Okay, masuk eh. Dimasukkan ke dalam equation ni untuk dapatkan 64.8 kilowatts. Okay. Kita tengok lagi one example, another examples mengenai a Shamu sprint. A killer whales are known to reach 32 feet in length and have a mass of over 8,000 kilogram. They are also very quick, able to accelerate up to 30 miles per hour in a matter of seconds. Disregarding the considerable drag force of water, calculate the average power a killer whale named Shamu with a mass 8,000 kilogram will need to generate to reach a span of 12 meter per second in 6 seconds. Berat ni soalan dia, kan? So apa dia cerita dia? Dia nak suruh cari apa tu? Calculate the average power. Again, nak suruh cari power. So macam-macam benda power, hanya ada beberapa equation dia. P equals to W per T. P equals to E per T. Okay. Lepas tu, kita boleh calculate daripada power tu boleh dapat force dan sebagainya. Okay, dalam case ini, we have a delta KE that equivalent to half mv squared minus half mv initial squared. Okay, so you put all the values like this. Well, m is the 8,000 kilogram minus with zero. Kenapa zero? Kenapa half mv final squared to zero? Apa tahu? Why yang belakang ni initially dia zero? Okay.
Tak faham dia ras.
Ha?
The wave tak faham dia ras.
Okay, sebab satu dia macam tu lah cakap bila dia start daripada rest, definitely kebiasaannya lah, biasanya kita akan start daripada rest. Sebab tu initially biasanya kosong. Tapi bukan semua keadaan macam tu So therefore kita boleh dapatkan delta KE bersama dengan 5.76 × 10⁵ joules. And then when you get that things, they divide with 6, with that divide with 6 seconds, then you can get 9.6 × 10⁴ watts. Okay, remember everything kalau nak rasa senang tukar kepada SI unit. Kita tukar pada SI unit. Okay. So maybe this one on speedboat ni I boleh try on your own Then I will try on your own untuk buat example yang last ni. Okay, kita terus pergi kepada potential energy curve and equipotential. Last but not least, last topics for today will be potential. Okay, saya nak highlightkan beberapa perkara yang macam ni je sebab I believe kalau nak explanation yang lebih jelas, kamu boleh tengok pada video yang saya dah suruh kamu tengok tu Okay. So, this is the potential energy curve and the equipotential. Okay, apa maksud dia of the equipotential? Senang cerita ialah we want to see the work done. Okay, tetapi menggunakan variable force. Tadi awal-awal tadi menggunakan constant force. Itu beza dia. Constant and variable force. Bila constant maksud dia force dia tetap. Macam kes ini lah. Ini constant. So untuk force yang constant senang. Bila F force against the position, okay, maksud dia graf dia akan dapat straight macam ni. Graf dia akan dapat straight line. Sebab value F dia tetap akan sama sampai bila-bila. So itu nama dia constant force. Tetapi dalam case yang inconsistent, kita akan tengok sekejap lagi what kind of graph that will appear. Okay, so this is force against positions. So area is the FD lah, F kali dengan D, which means FD, which ialah work. Sama juga, if the force takes on several successive constant values, so it will be like this. Okay, we can then approximate a continuously varying force by a succession of constant values. Okay, senang cerita, tadi kita nampak semua equations, line-line, semuanya dalam bentuk straight line. Tetapi not this one. This one is the curve line. Bila curve line, how to solve an area issues? Okay, macam mana kita nak calculate? Obviously, kita akan calculate area under the graph. Okay, but we need to apply, integrations baru boleh dapat. Kan? Tetapi itulah dia cerita dia sekarang ni. Sebenarnya apa-apa pun kita akan mudahkan you masih dia nak dapatkan value work. So daripada graph force against position, remember to do it area under the graph. Okay, do it area under the graph. Okay, so the last part for today is the work done in the stretching spring. Okay, stretching spring. Kalau kamu tengok tadi, stretching the spring sama jugalah dengan PE equals to half KX squared. Half KX squared. Okay, so maksud dia sama juga macam work done. Work done sama. Sebab itulah cerita di dalam ni dia akan sentuh energy. Tanpa kamu sedar, dia cerita pasal energy, dia cerita pasal work, dia cerita pasal potential energy. Semua tu nilai dia joule. Bila nilai dia joule, cara kita nak baca pun lebih mudah. Maksudnya kita tahu, ni sebenarnya ialah satu family. All are from the same family. Okay, because it can, it have a half kx square. K is the spring constant, x is the elongation. So that's why, yeah. Okay, let's look at last examples for today. One end of a horizontal spring that equivalent to K, ni dia pakai horizontal spring, K equals to 80 Newton per meter is held fixed, while an external force is applied to the free end. Stretching is slowly from x equals to 0 and x equals to 4 centimeters. Find the work done by the applied force on the spring. Find the additional work done in stretching the spring from x, the x 4 centimeters to 7 x and b 4 centimeters to x and c 7 centimeters. So ada beberapa keadaan ada kat situ. We have an applied force and we have elongation at 4 centimeters and also 7 centimeters. Okay, so find the work done by the applied force on the spring. Okay, so half kx square, masukkan value dia, k equals to 80 Newton per meter and x equivalent to 0.04. Macam mana dia dapat? Ini dia tukar 4 cm kepada meter. So, dapat dalam joule. Ha, tapi kalau tak tukar dalam centimeter, tak tukar dalam meter, tak boleh. Kena calculate dulu, eh. So, sama juga dalam part B, find the additional work done in stretching the spring from x equals to 4 to x equals to 7. And again, kalau kamu tengok macam mana dia buat, dia calculate balik. Kan? Dia dah tahu x equals to 4 berapa. So jawapan tadi, dia masuk je kat sini. Yang ni dia calculate baru. So dia dapat perbezaan dia ialah 0.132 joules. Okay. Ada soalan tak? Apa? Kita stop sekejap. Azan. Okay, so do you have any questions? Or we... Ada soalan?
No.
No, ni macam. Okay, so next week, please watch the video on our first hour. Hari Isnin, tolong tengok video dulu. Lepas tu, hari Khamis, baru kita akan discuss macam ni lah. Okay, hari Isnin saya bagi chance untuk awak tengok video. Kemungkinan besar saya akan upload dekat YouTube lah supaya mudahkan awak untuk stream video-video tu. Kalau tak sempat, saya akan bagi link terus kepada Google Drive. Which one is better? Okay. Alright, so I think if you don't have a questions, then I think we'll stop here. Thank you very thank you for your attentions. Inshallah, we'll see you next week. Okay, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.